Welcome to Re'e Yisrael, which means in English, Behold, O Israel, the Bible teaching television ministry of Congregation Shema Yisrael. Shema Yisrael is a Messianic Jewish congregation in Rochester, New York. Be sure to get out your Bible and a notebook and follow along with this week's lesson from the Scriptures.
All right, would you all rise again? And we are going to do the pre-Torah blessing. So you'll see it split up on the screen there, the first line, second line. So I do the first, you do the second as a response, and then the next screen we all sing together. Baruch Hu Et Adonai Hamvorach. Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam, asher bachar banu mikol ha'amim, v'natan lanu et Torato. Baruch atah Adonai, notein ha'Torah. Amen. Bless the Lord, the Blessed One. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has chosen us from all peoples and given us his Torah. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, giver of the Torah. Amen.
You can be seated. I'm going to be reading from Genesis chapter 49, verses 8 through 10. Yehuda, that's how you say Judah in Hebrew. Yehuda. Ata yoducha echecha. You shall be praised by your brothers. Yadcha ba'oref oivecha. Your hand shall be on the neck of your enemies. Yishtachavu lecha b'nei avicha. They will bow down to you, the sons of your father. Gur aryeh, the cub of a lion. Yehuda. Yehuda is the cub of a lion. Miteref. Bini Alita rises from his prey, my son. Kara Ravatz Ka'aryeh, and he lies down like a lion. Ul Kalavi mi Kemenu, and like a lioness, no one will disturb him. Lo Yasur Shevet, the scepter shall not depart. Mi Yehuda from Judah, the scepter shall not depart from Yehuda. U mehochek, or the staff, bein raglav, from between his feet. Od ki yavo, until comes Shiloh. Belo yehochat amim, and to him will be the obedience of the people. So, Lord, we thank you for your word, and we just ask that as David comes, you would open our ears and our eyes and our minds and our wills and our hearts to receive what you have put in his heart to share with us today. In Yeshua's name, amen.
Shabbat Shalom. I feel like I always come up here with a lot of stuff and then I'm always kind of putting it somewhere. So, good morning. I'm excited about what I'm going to talk about. I'm actually a little nervous, too. Guys like me definitely get nervous about different things. Because I want to do my best, like anybody else. I want to communicate something clearly that's in my heart. And I don't know if you've ever tried to communicate something that was in your heart that was kind of deep with your mouth, and then you felt like you were at a loss for words. Has that ever happened to you? Amen. And then you got to try to do it in front of, well, probably about 70 people here, you know? So, but I appreciate your prayers and all the prayers already, for just for clarity of thought, clarity of words, and open hearts. And I want to start just by saying this. This is kind of, I just felt impressed to do this last night and to include this because I was talking to Cassie. Cassie's my wife. Many of you know her, and I was chatting with her yesterday, and you know, we're in a big time of transition, something that we've never done before. We've lived in the South our whole life. You know, we're coming to the North, we're leaving things we know. There's just a lot of things going on, and it's good. Okay, it's very good, but it's busy, and there's just a lot of things where we're transitioning from one place. There's closure, there's relationships to kind of tie up and wrap up, and new ones we're making. There's just a lot of things, and when that happens, you can get distracted. You ever been distracted? A couple of you have been distracted, but I get distracted sometimes, all right? And on the way up here, I was just thinking, I was thinking about a lot of things. A lot of cares. A lot of cares. But I began to realize something. It just kind of just dawned on me. Like, I am a extremely blessed individual. Like, I just, it was as simple as that. It wasn't because of something. I was just like, I'm so blessed. And God, I feel so favored. Like, I just see favor all around me. The thing is, it's not because everything around me is perfect. We can all look around our lives and not everything's perfect. You can look into your own individual life. I am not totally sanctified. There's areas of my life I want to change. But it's like, but in the midst of it, I'm still really, really blessed and really, really favored. It's just amazing. And I say that not to say that I'm being blessed because I'm doing something right. It's because he's good. And I don't know why. I've tried searching for years as to why he would be good to a guy like me. And at some point, you just accept it. Or you don't. But if you don't accept it, yeah, life is tough. Why did I share that? Probably because one person needed to hear that. At least. And I need to say it. I love what you did, Rabbi Jim, because that's what I felt like doing, was just bending my knee to our Father, to God, because he's so good. I want to give him the glory. And you know, this isn't even my message. It's just something I want to say. Maybe it should have been. But, you know, you might be thinking, wow, I wish my life was blessed. Like, don't look. Sometimes we're just looking at the wrong things. We have to learn how to come out of ourselves before things get right. Before things are, quote, good by our definition. We come out of ourselves and we realize how blessed we are to be alive, to be in a building, and to know God. I mean, I was just thinking about this morning, like, I mean, I see through a glass darkly, trust me, but I know God. Like, I can go to him, and I know things about him, and he has shared things with me, and he's comforted me, and he's healed me of things, and he's given me things, and he has directed my life in the midst of me fumbling through it at times. But nothing brings me more joy and more peace in the midst of my own journey, problems within, problems without, than knowing I am blessed. And then being grateful for that. In Deuteronomy 28, you want to know the real secret? It's not a secret, it's written right there in plain scripture. Secrets, they're written down. You just got to go find them. The reason that curses came, okay, it wasn't because they weren't perfect. It's because they did not serve the Lord their God with joyfulness and gladness in heart. They didn't recognize all that they had been blessed with. They were so focused on other stuff. And when we do that, it's difficult to bring glory to God, give glory to God, to be thankful, and to really have peace. You guys are getting to know me. I'm getting to know you, and that's very important. You will continue to get to know me. I will continue to get to know you as I become part of the congregation here at Shema Israel. And so I I don't disclose every aspect of my life. You know, there's certain things that you share with certain people and, you know, not other people. There's wisdom in that. But I want you guys to know me. I want you, I feel that it's important. I want you to know who I am as a guy, not a speaker only. Or whatever else I may do, whatever call there may be, or whatever I do in the kingdom of God, and whatever you do in the kingdom of God. I want you to really know me and my family and Cassie as people. And that we're not perfect. Not that you think we are, but I just have to say these things. You know? And this helps me connect with you. And I woke up, I'd say about, I don't know, well, it was probably like Monday or something. And I woke up really disoriented. Like I woke up from sleep, okay? And I woke up really disoriented, but not like a disoriented, like I'm just wiping the, you know, the kind of tiredness from my eyes, like feeling very spiritually disoriented. Like, where's God? Like, it's not like, what am I going to do today? It's like, what am I doing in life? Like, what's going on? And you might think that's hard. Like, how could I be there with, and because there's so much direction and so much leading I've had. But nevertheless, that was right there. And I felt like, boy, I'm really groping through something right now. You know, what's going on? And just felt disoriented. Went to go pray, kind of not feeling very connected. Don't raise your hand. You ever been there? So that's happening. And so that's where all right, God, I need help. I need help. And the way that God has worked with me over the years in helping me is a scripture will come to my mind. Now, he works with different people different ways, but for whatever reason, and this isn't the only isolated way he's ever dealt with me, but this is the normal way. A scripture will come to my mind. And when I was first on this journey, and I still do this, the scripture sometimes seems very disconnected to what my problem is. All right, and I would think, well, that can't be the answer because it seems so disconnected. But I'm learning to follow it. And there's an answer. And what came to my heart was this: the just shall live by faith. Okay, and the disorientation, I was wanting something very tangible to sink my nails into and grab onto and say, you know, take me to the safe place. But all I heard in my heart and in my mind was the just shall live. By faith, we could say by their faith. What does it mean to live by faith? Like, does that mean that you just kind of exist? No, it's what makes you tick. It's what brings you joy and passion. It's what you live by. It's what you get up for in the morning. And you and I, as believers, we live by our faith. You don't live by anything else. The scriptures give us no other option. And I'm so thankful for that. I'm a this or that guy. You will get to know that about me. It's this or that. I don't do well with options. Chicken or steak, like, give me, you know, that's about the extent of my options. And if that gets too confusing, just give me one. I'm going to eat it, and it's going to be good. It's fine. So I don't need a lot of options. In Scripture, this is, says, David, this is how you're going to live. By faith. So any other way that maybe we've had in our mind that we want to live, some other way we want to do it, be best if we just kind of brush it off to the side, because God's not going to bend to it. This is what he said. We're going to live by faith. Okay, so that scripture is starting to come, and that was encouraging me, because when I think about faith, I begin to think about, well, what do I have faith in? I mean, the faith is in something. It's not just, oh, I'm a, you know, person of faith. People say they're optimists. And I'm not saying that's a wrong statement, but I'm saying, well, what are you optimistic about? Well, oh, just life. Really? Serious. Good for you, because I've not been able to arrive at that. Around every corner, it's like just something else. Does that mean I'm not blessed? Nope. Not at all. It means that this is not our final destination. You know the story. I mean, this world's been tainted by sin. So I got the just shall live by faith. And remember, this is what like makes you tick. This is what makes you go. I remember a few years ago, early on in my journey, it was like a couple years into our marriage, Cassie and me. I remember sitting around talking one night, because I struggled. I struggled with faith in the beginning of my journey. I struggled with a lot of things. And I was talking to her. I was like, Cassie, how do you get passionate about something? I mean, I feel like I'm good at a lot of things, but I don't feel like I'm really, like, really passionate about something. Something that I don't really like. I'll be excited for like 2 weeks, and then I'm like, yeah, on to the next thing. Like, how do you get and stay passionate about something? I mean, that's, you know, I was asking the million-dollar question for all of humanity. You know, we would talk about these things, but my topic today is what I am passionate about. All right, and it may be something that you're passionate about, may not be, but at least you'll know what makes David tick. Okay, and different things make us tick. All right, that's why we are the body of Messiah. If it was all the same thing, we'd all be looking the same, and that wouldn't work. Now, the just shall live by faith. Romans 10:17. All right, faith comes by hearing. Hearing by what? The word of God. So I'm going to live by my faith. That's going to make me tick. But my faith has got to be in something. And how does it even come? It comes by the word of God. So I got to go look in the word of God to put my faith into something. And then maybe I can live off of that. So all that being said, in this disorientation that I'm having this past Monday, trying to figure it out, I'm going back to the scriptures. The ones that really have just gripped my heart over the years. That honestly have thrust me and propelled me even to where I'm standing right here today on Shabbat. Not a Sunday, but on Shabbat. If you get my drift. Let me read you something. Because I want to get into some biblical prophecy. Now, when I say the word prophecy, I don't want to put this on you, but I know for me, on my journey, when I'd hear the word prophecy, my mind would go many places. People use the word prophecy for many things. Correctly? Yes, and incorrectly. Okay? So, you know, I want you to really know where I'm coming from when I'm saying prophecy. Now, I believe in the gift of prophecy. I operate at times in the spiritual gift of prophecy. I have. And I recognize it as a legitimate gift in this present time, okay? But what I'm talking about today is biblical prophecy. The things the prophets have written that we can go back and read time and time and time and time again. I was doing an assignment for a class, a seminary course I was taking, and I wrote something about prophecy. And there was like some question like, why is Psalm 22 important to you? Which is a wonderful prophecy about Messiah and his, well, I don't know if it's wonderful, but it's definitely a prophecy about Messiah and his death, how he would die. I mean, it's vivid. And it was written, I don't know the time frame, but hundreds of years before Yeshua actually died. I said this, why is it important? Very simple, one reason. My faith is based on the knowledge of the Word of God. That's it. My faith, what I put my trust in, my hope in, it can only be based on what's written. Now, people may say things to me. I might hear a great teaching. Some might even prophesy to me. And that can encourage me and affirm me. But my faith that I won't ever move off of is in the Word of God. When I see prophecy written centuries before, and then it happens just as it said it would, it increases my faith. Remember, we live by faith. The more faith you're getting, the more you're living. Amen. Okay? Prophecy goes beyond coincidence and helps me know and understand that I serve and trust a God that is able to know things long before they will happen and is sovereign to make sure that they do. In ministry, I don't want people to have a blind or superstitious belief in God. I want to help them know why they believe what they believe, and to be confident in that. To do that, we need a foundation. And prophecy is that foundation. Otherwise, our faith is an idea, at best a philosophy, rather than absolute fact and truth. I want to see if I can do something this morning. I won't be able to see it visibly. I don't want to coerce you into doing anything. I expect absolutely no response. It'll be a very individual thing. But I want to see if I can get your hearts inside of you to burn for God. Like, literally just be stirred to where you're like, what is happening? And it just takes you like, I gotta find out more. I know we've got our individual problems. I know things are going on. I know from day to day, I mean, there's things going on. But let's just, for a moment, not that you're not, but let's come out of ourselves. Let's just look at the Word of God in the midst of our problems and look at that rather than the problems. And you may be surprised how much peace will come to you. Because what is written is true. What is happening today is temporary. What is written is eternal. Okay, so let's begin here. Now, how am I going to do this? How in the world can a guy like me that's just, you know, fumbles through life, you know, just like anybody else, how could I be somebody that could come and make your hearts burn? Well, I don't think I really can, but I can maybe lead you to a place that will, all right? And I'm going to show you my formula, because it's Yeshua's formula, all right? I don't have a formula. God has a formula, sort of. And where he does it his way, I try my best to do it that way. So let's go to Luke 24, 27 through 32. Now I want to let you know, I'm reading from the King James Version. I like the King James Version, but not for all things. I'm not a King James Version onlyer. You ever heard of them? Okay. I mean, if they are, you are, you know. But I'm not a King James Version onlyer. That's my own made-up word. You can tell. But there were some certain scriptures that were omitted from other translations that the King James did not omit that I think are actually very important, I think are in the original manuscript. So I decided to use King James today. And if I use King James for one, I will try to use it through the rest of them, just for consistency's sake, but just so you know where I'm at. And I'll try to transliterate Jesus into Yeshua where I can and do my best with that. Okay, so Luke 24, 27 through 32. Now let me give you a little preface here. So this is after the resurrection of Yeshua, all right? And there's some disciples that have come and found this guy. He's met him on where? The road to where? Emmaus, all right? And he did something with them, and this is what I want to read here. He began to do something with them when they were all sad about, oh, didn't you hear that great prophet, Yeshua? Oh, the chief priest and the scribe, they killed him. That's what they said, okay? They killed him. You know, they condemned him to death. They didn't kill him, they condemned him to death, I think is what it says. So then we have this here. So Luke 24, 27, it says this. And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, that would be, beginning at Moses would be the book of Genesis. Now, I know that's up for debate, but not with me. Okay, because there's what we call messianic prophecy in the book of Genesis, and Yeshua would not have skipped those. Okay, and if he's beginning at Moses, that would tell me Moses wrote the book of Genesis. Anyway, that's a rabbit trail. Let's go. Beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded unto them in all the scriptures, all of them. I'm not going to do that today. That would take way too long. All the scriptures, the things concerning himself. Keep going. Next verse, yeah. And they drew nigh unto the village where they went, and he made as though he would have gone further. But they constrained him, saying, abide with us, for it's almost evening, and the day is far spent. And so he went, and he tarried with them. He stayed with them. And it came to pass as he set at meat with them, he took bread, blessed it, brake it, and gave it to them. And their eyes were opened, and they knew him, and then he vanished out of their sight. And they said one to another, did not our heart burn within us while he talked with us by the way, and while he opened to us the scriptures? So that's my formula, is I'm going to attempt to open a scripture to you that by his presence and the scriptures being open and explained, that word open means expounded, that something will happen in your heart to the work of the Holy Spirit that will increase your faith, increase your vitality in life, your joy in God, your desire to go to him. So that's what we're going to do. So what we're going to do is we're going to go to one of my favorite messianic prophecies. Yeshua would have read this to these gentlemen because all the scriptures. So this is one that he would have gone over with them. So we're just guys like they are. We're just on the road to Emmaus, and we're going to let the word come, speak to us, expound to us who he is, his nature, his identity, to the end that our hearts will burn in a good way. Okay, Genesis 49, verses 8 through 12. One of the things that has, I've taught on this a couple times, and the difficulty I had with it both times, no, I only taught on once. I taught on one time. The difficulty I had with it was that I could not exhaust it. What I mean by that is usually in a teaching, I feel like I can, okay, here's some scriptures, here's what they mean, here's some application, here's some other scriptures, and then we can kind of come and I can kind of wrap it up and make a nice like package and give it to the people. And that's kind of sometimes what I do. But it's there is no way to fully exhaust this prophecy. It goes on and on. You cannot exhaust the ways it's being fulfilled, the ways it will be fulfilled. I mean, it's amazing. You could spend the rest of Shabbat just trying to figure it out. And longer. So let's go there. Genesis 49. Let's start in verse 8. I think we're on verse 11 there. Can you go to verse 8? Okay, I'm going to read out of the Bible. Scriptures here. All right, Genesis 49. This is what Rabbi Jim read from the Torah scroll. Let's see, what should I do? Oh, there it is. Okay. I'm going to take one verse at a time. I usually might read through the whole thing. I'm going to take one verse at a time. I'm going to talk about it. There's more to it than meets just a casual reading. Judah. This is Jacob blessing his sons. All right, that's the context of this, and he's come to Judah. Judah, you are he whom your brethren shall praise. Stop. Now, we know here that this is not talking specifically about Judah. Okay? I don't see any indication anywhere after this that his literal brothers, Jacob's sons, praised him individually. This is talking about Judah's lineage, his generations after him, and the generations of his brother after him. All right? Judah, you are he whom your brethren shall praise. Now, back then, they wouldn't have really understood this necessarily. Like, what does this all mean? We understand this. Having, you know, this side of the new covenant, we totally understand this. We understand Yeshua from the tribe of Judah, the line of the tribe of Judah. We get this. But look at it. Judah, you are he whom your brethren shall praise. You know what that means? It means that every time a Jew praises Yeshua, this prophecy is being fulfilled. Think about that. Think about that. Now, let me just get technical for just a second. There's some basic principles that I adhere to in interpreting prophecy in the New Covenant when it's mentioned, all right? The first is called a literal fulfilled prophecy. An example of this would be the virgin birth. So Isaiah in chapter 7, you know, behold, the Lord himself shall give you a sign, a virgin shall conceive, you shall call his name Emmanuel. Did that literally happen? Yes, it did. If you're a believer, it did. Okay? If you're not, you may be weighing and considering that. But it did. That's a literal fulfillment. There's no allegory to it. There's no symbolism to it. A woman who is a virgin, supernaturally conceived, bore a child, and he was the only begotten Son of God. That's a literal fulfillment. Then you have something called literal plus typology. Literal plus typology. So an example of this would be like in Matthew 2 when it talks about Joseph had the dream and they went into Egypt to protect Yeshua because Herod was mad and wanted to kill all the young boys. So he goes into Egypt, but then he comes out and what does it say? Out of Egypt I have called my son. That's fulfilling the prophecy. Out of Egypt I have called my son. But have you ever gone back and read that prophecy? It's nothing to do with Yeshua. Has to do with calling Israel out of Egypt, Hosea 11:1. But there's a typology in it, you see? So that literally happened, we know, because God called Israel out of Egypt, but Yeshua was also a type. He's so closely associated with Israel, he's also a type. God's son, he was called out of Egypt, and then he went into Nazareth. All right? So that's what it's talking about there. So if you've ever tried to wonder, like, well, it doesn't seem to be talking about that, that's why. It's literal plus typology, and that's a valid way of interpreting prophecy in the New Covenant. The other way is literal plus application. Literal plus application. An example of this would be at Shavuot, when the apostles were baptized and filled with the Holy Spirit. All right? And then Peter got up and he did this. He preached a sermon on what? Joel chapter 2, Joel 2:28. Okay, in those days all flesh, well let me read it, I'll paraphrase it, mess it up. Let me just read it here. I don't have it on the screen. Joel, back here somewhere. Here we go. Joel 2:28. It shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams. Your young men shall see visions. And also upon the servants and upon the handmaids in those days will I pour out my spirit. Now, Peter said, you know, because some people thought that these guys were drunk because they were speaking in other tongues. And he said, no, they're not drunk. This is what the prophet Joel spoke of. But the prophet Joel is saying what? The Spirit of God is going to be poured out on all flesh in Israel. Has that happened yet? Not yet. Not the literal. So Peter here is talking about a literal plus application. There's going to be a big literal fulfillment of it, but there are other things happening working up to it. Do you get my drift here? There's other things working up to it. So, going back, let's leave that now. Let's go back to Genesis 49. Judah, you are he whom your brethren shall praise. One day, not just the brethren, but all the earth shall bend their knee and bow to the Lord Yeshua. Okay? And we will praise him. It's going to be amazing when he comes back. But there's a literal application even here today, even from the days of Yeshua, in that any time a Jew would praise Yeshua, this prophecy is being fulfilled. To me, that makes my heart burn. Because I see the Word of God weaving together something that no man could ever do. It goes beyond my intellect. It goes beyond coincidence to me. And it gets me excited about knowing God and knowing the Word of God. Your hand shall be in the neck of your enemies. Now, we know that King David, descendant of Judah, right? What did he say in Psalm 18? My hand is in the neck of my enemies. More prophecy being fulfilled hundreds of years later. And we know that Yeshua will put all enemies under his feet. Okay? So this is happening. Maybe you've seen it in your own individual lives where your enemies have been put under your feet. Your father's children shall bow down before thee. Who are your father's children? Those are his brothers. This is Israel. All Israel, one day, as it says in Romans, will be saved. And they will bow down before Yeshua. But the way I see this in verse 8, any time a Jew bends their knee, praises Yeshua, from the tribe of Judah, bows down before him. This prophecy is being fulfilled, and it's just rolling on and rolling on and rolling on until one day we're going to see a huge, huge fulfillment of it. See, that motivates me. I'm motivated to see prophecy fulfilled. Because, you know, when prophecy is fulfilled, you know what's happening on the earth? God's will is being done. And there's nothing better than that. Let's go to the next verse. Verse 9. Judah's a lion's whelp. From the prey, my son, thou art gone up. He stooped down, he couched as a lion, and as an old lion. Who shall rouse him up? When the angel of the Lord came to John and gave him the book of Revelation, what's one of the things that was spoken of about who Yeshua is? He's what? The lion. You ever wonder where that came from? Or you just think something like it just appeared somewhere? We got it on flags, we got it on pictures, we got this lion. He's everywhere. Where did that come from? Or was that original? Was the book of Revelation the first time that concept that Yeshua is the lion of the tribe of Judah, is that the first time that concept had ever come up? No way. It had come up thousands of years before. Or a couple thousand years before. Where? In Genesis 49, verse 9. So you can see where it originated. And I scoured the scriptures. I don't see him being called the lion of the tribe of Judah anywhere except here and in Revelation. Now, if I'm wrong about that, I'd like to know, because that'd be great for me to know. But I couldn't find it. It was here and in Revelation. So why would I have faith that he is the lion of the tribe of Judah? Because somebody said it after the fact? No, because somebody said it before the fact. Keep going. Verse 10. This is very interesting. The scepter shall not depart from Judah, nor a lawgiver from between his feet until Shiloh come, and unto him shall the gathering of the people be. Now, this is where I thought about this later, and I don't like the way King James renders this, because Shiloh here, the word in Hebrew is not a proper name. It should be Shiloh. It should actually say, until him to whom it belongs shall come. All right, so it's describing a person. But now let's talk about a scepter. And I know a scepter, we often think of it as a symbol of rulership, and it is. But one of the other things, as I studied this out, it represents is tribal identity. So each tribe had a scepter, and a scepter identified them as a tribe, okay? So if we were to insert that, let's just say that that's what they're meaning here. I'm not totally sure, to be honest with you, but let's say that that is. I think it makes sense, because you could say the tribal identity shall not depart from Judah, nor a lawgiver, that would be a ruler, an overseer, a sovereign king, from between his feet, until he to whom it belongs shall come. Let's break this down. Why does this get me excited? If scepter means tribal identity. In 70 AD, we had the destruction of the temple, correct? One of the things that happened at the destruction of the temple was that the tribes lost the records of who was who, as I understand it. I do think there were some things put in place. The Levites were able to retain some of their identity and their genealogy. Maybe some of the others. But the 10 of the tribes had lost their identity years before. Only Judah was really hanging on to theirs. All right? But then 70 AD, is that before or after Yeshua came? After, okay. Records are destroyed. And today, I don't think anybody can really make a great argument that they're from the tribe of Judah. There's just too much lost. Okay? That's my take on it. Now, why is all this important? Think about it. If Messiah had not come yet, there's really no way to identify him. But you see, the scepter shall not depart from Judah, nor a lawgiver from between his legs until he to whom it belongs has come. Well, he to whom it belongs has come, so guess what? The scepter has departed from Judah, the tribal identity. Why? Because he's come. The tribe of Judah has already come. He's already been identified. And so this scripture to me is indicating that Messiah must come before the destruction of the temple. I don't have a lot of faith after the fact, because there's no way to identify. You following me? Or is this maybe it's just how I get burned. I don't know. But this gets me excited because this grounds my faith. This concretes my faith. I don't have to be ashamed of it because I can prove it. Not from my head or intellect, but from the scriptures. And I can stand on this. And if someone wants to argue with it, fine. But good luck finding the Messiah from the tribe of Judah because you can't really identify it. He's identifiable before the destruction of the temple, but not after, from my understanding. And if I need to be corrected, email me or something, okay? And when I say that, I don't say that sarcastically. Like, you can ask Cassie. Give me your questions. If I say something wrong, tell me. Email me. Let's talk. Like, I don't have an axe to grind. I don't need to be right. Except I need to be right, but not for my sake. Like, I just need to be right in the scripture. So if I'm wrong, tell me, and we can, you know, chat about it. But this gets me so excited because I've never seen him, but he knows me, and I know the one that fulfilled this. People are looking for passion. They're looking for something to sink their teeth into. They're looking for something they can give their whole lives to. I can give my life to this. Written 4,000 years ago, and it's still playing out today. No one can say that about anything else that they believe, except us as believers in the scriptures. Okay, verse 11. Binding his foal unto the vine, and his ass's colt unto the choice vine, he washed his garments in wine, and his clothes in the blood of grapes. Keep going to the next one. His eyes shall be red with wine, and his teeth white with milk. What does this mean? I really thought about a lot of different symbolism for this. But I think it's as simple as this, and there's probably more to it, is that when he comes, and something that's ongoing, is that the land of Israel is going to be very fruitful. The grapevines are going to be so thick you can tie a donkey to it and it won't rip them out of the ground. And you know something? As many of you know, that's been happening. Israel is flourishing. The grapes are coming back. It's going to be so rich with vegetation that his eyes will be red with wine. It's like a symbol of just overflowing. And his teeth white with milk. It's a land flowing with milk and honey. And it's going to be fruitful. When Israel became a nation state in 1948, as many of you know, some of you watching may not know, the land came back to life. The land has always come back to life or become desolate based on if Israel was there or not. And when they came back, they began to have life again. Listen, when I see like these documentaries and pictures of grapevines on the hills of Samaria, I don't say, boy, God's up to something. I say, God is fulfilling the scriptures. That's different. That's different. It's not wrong to say God's up to something. I mean, he's always up to something. But I say, God is fulfilling the scriptures. Go back to verse 10. I forgot something. To him shall be, what is it, the obedience of the people? Yeah. Unto him shall the gathering of the people be. Really, literally means to him shall be the obedience of the people. People here is not the goyim. All right, and I studied this out, tried to understand it, but it's used in Scripture for both nations and the people of Israel. So either way you want to take it, it also includes the Gentiles. Nations, this one that we're in, for the most part, was founded on Judeo-Christian principles, as you know, okay? And Yeshua has been a central figure in this nation. It's fulfilling something there. And to him shall the gathering of the people be. Anytime a Gentile comes into the fold, verse 10 is being fulfilled. In you, Abraham, shall all the nations of the earth be blessed. So all of us together can find ourselves in these four scriptures. If you have an ear to hear, and if you want to hear. Yep, I'm stuck. Here we go. Okay, so You guys know this. I'm pretty new to Messianic Judaism. And so I'm not a guy that does things flippantly, especially when it comes to the Lord. Now, you know, just day-to-day stuff sometimes. But not when it comes to things of the Lord, God, or the Word. I just don't do anything flippantly. And so, you know, when God really began leading me into Messianic Judaism, I'm saying, what is this really about? What is this? What am I needing to understand? What does this represent? And you know what I see now? When I look at Messianic Judaism, I don't see a movement. I see Zechariah 8:23. I see Isaiah 56:8. I see Romans 11:25. I see scriptures. That's how I see it. It's a wonderful when you can be a part of something, begin to move in something corporately and individually, and you see it through scriptures. Because then you know you're in the will of God. What about the regathering of Israel? What about the great? I mean, all those things. I don't just see, you know, the nation state. I see Isaiah 43. I see Isaiah 11:10. I see Ezekiel 36. I don't say God's up to something in Israel. I say the scriptures are being fulfilled. And that makes my heart burn because I don't know of a human on this planet that's ever existed that could predict these things so accurately. It has to be God. Too many different people he inspired to write things that come together, that work together perfectly. That makes my heart burn. Because you know why it makes my heart burn? I'm able to believe it, that it's really true. Because it's beyond coincidence. I don't want you having a blind faith. I can't live off of blind faith. I mean, I know we don't see with our physical eyes, but the scriptures and the prophets have spoken. And he's doing things in these days. I don't see all these things that have been going on in the world. Okay? COVID and everything else. I don't just see that. You know what I see? Birth pains. This is how I process. And it's weird because a lot of people don't process that way. But maybe we should. We should. I'm not saying we don't do anything about these things, but I'm telling you, that is my lens. So getting to know me, that's my lens. When I see things going on, I mean, even some of the things going on with Russia, I see Ezekiel 38:39. I mean, whether that's literal right now or not, I can't say. But there's things moving in those directions. Okay? So here we are. And if we look at these scriptures, and we understand Yeshua not just from New Covenant on, but we see who he was and what the prophet said about him from Genesis 3:15 onward through, because that's what it's all about. Is a people, a nation, and a seed. And then the nations being gathered unto that. That's what the whole Bible is about. It's amazing to be a part of it. I look at myself. What's going on with me? How am I to view myself? You know how I view myself right now? I'm going to be very honest with you. I'm a provoked Jew. I hope that's not offensive. No, seriously. I really hope that's not an offensive term, Rabbi Jim. I don't know if it's I don't know. But that's how I view it right now. I'm a provoked Jew. I resisted this for years. Ask Cassie. When I came back from this place, from Shema in November, last November, I didn't tell anybody, like, you know, what was going on or different things. And Rabbi Jim and I had some conversations, and that was totally unexpected. On my part and his part, he didn't expect it either. Okay? I didn't tell anybody about it. I was like, I ain't telling nobody about this. Let's see what happens. I had more, I will say, you know, Gentiles come to me and say, are you going to get into Messianic Judaism, David? And I'd say, why are you saying these things? Stop it. You know? And it was the most random thing. Seemingly random. I mean, I did not give these people any indication. And then I found out there have been people praying for me to get into Messianic Judaism for years. I was provoked into it. You know, something that's very biblical for Gentiles to provoke Jews to believing in their Messiah. So why let it be offensive? It's very, very biblical. So when I look at myself, that's kind of what I see right now. I'm a provoked Jew. It's scriptural. So I'm in the will of God. Isn't that great? It's supposed to happen in these days. You know? It's supposed to happen in these days. And so by the scriptures and prophecy, I understand in part, I mean, no one can say fully, but where I am right now in this journey and in the will of God, and you can as well through biblical prophecy. You really, really can. And Jew and Gentile have a wonderful commission to do together in this. And you see how it's working. You see how it's working. Ephesians 2:20. And are built upon the foundation of the emissaries, the apostles, and the prophets. Yeshua, HaMashiach himself being the chief cornerstone. What is our foundation? What I just talked about. I personally have none other. I personally have no other foundation. I've tried to build them. They fall down. I'm really bad at it. Angles are not good. I mean, it's just horrible. And then, you know, I get a good foundation and I get great ideas about how to build on it. They're horrible too. They just crumble. He's the foundation. He's the builder. I'm just, yes, sir. The best I know how. So this is our foundation. This is the foundation of our faith. If you want some other way, I honestly don't want to tell you. So this is the foundation. This is where I come from. All right. And not to say that nobody else here doesn't come from here. I'm trying to let you know just about me, so you need to know me a little bit more. Now, I want to close with something, because maybe some of you were interested in what I talked about, maybe some of you weren't. But it's understanding, and you don't have to be a scholar. I am not a scholar. Trust me, I'm not. And do I understand messianic prophecy and prophecy about Israel perfectly? Nope. But I get the idea. I get the motion. I get the spirit of it. And I do understand some of the literal things and some of the intricacies of it. Okay? And I feel like I can hold my own in a lot of conversations, whatever that means. But we got to begin somewhere. And all of us are called and commissioned to this, because every major doctrine and event that we put our faith in, like the death of Yeshua and his resurrection, was all spoken of before. I mean, don't raise your hand. I mean, and this is not to make anybody feel guilty, but this is a question. If somebody came up to you and said, prove that the resurrection was spoken of before it happened, could you do it? I can. Because it's written down. It's just written down. We just have to go find it. And that's why I have a foundation in it. And that's why Yeshua could say, hey, in 3 days I'm going to be raised up from the dead. Not because it was a new idea, but because it was a prophetic foundation that he had there. So our faith is in these things. Listen, I said before, you know, I have operated in the gift of prophecy at times. I'm not saying I'm a prophet. There are prophets, and even in present day. Okay, so I'm not against these things, but I'll tell you, we may need to not keep looking out for people that keep prophesying future events and then have to keep changing it. We just need to go to the original scriptures, because those don't change. They do not change. I love it. It's a sure word. They don't change. Peter said, we have a more sure word. Okay, I want to read you something. I promise you I'm closing up here. I'm becoming one of those guys. I want to read you something. What I'm about to read you is not a prophetic statement. I don't consider it a prophetic statement. It's just something I wanted to tell you. But I felt like I needed to write it down and read it to you, so I said exactly what I wanted to say about it. And again, this is from a guy, kind of the new guy. Okay, kind of coming in from the outsider, looking in, observing for a few years, and seeing, I think, something very important about Messianic Judaism as a whole. What I'm about to read does not make Messianic Judaism the pinnacle, or the thing to be attained to, or that everybody has to be a part of it. But I think it helps identify a part that we play in the whole body of Messiah. Do you see what I'm saying? Okay, so this is not for superiority's sake at all. Days are coming that the world and the church will look to Messianic Judaism and those that have joined themselves to Messianic Judaism for answers. It is our task, and I would say, and responsibility, to understand and explain the scriptures so their hearts will burn within them for God and Yeshua. Let's go to Acts chapter 8, verse 26 through 38. This is the story of the Ethiopian eunuch and Philip. And this is what I'm talking about. What Philip does is exactly what we should be able to do, and I think what we're called to do, and I think people are going to need to know it, how to do it at this level, okay? It's not an intimidating thing. It's just we need to start giving ourselves to it, all right? Listen, I became a believer through an organization that uses four spiritual laws, and they're wonderful spiritual laws, but there's a lack of depth to it, okay? That it's not going to reach some people. They need something more to sink their teeth into. Acts 26, okay, I'm going to go through 38. I'm going to read a good chunk here. And the angel of the Lord spake unto Philip, saying, Arise, go toward the south unto the way that goes down from Jerusalem unto Gaza, which is desert. And he rose and went, and behold, a man of Ethiopia, a eunuch of great authority under Candace, queen of the Ethiopians, who had the charge of all her treasure and had come to Jerusalem for to worship, was returning and sitting in his chariot and read Isaiah the prophet. Then the Spirit said unto Philip, Go near and join yourself to this chariot. And Philip ran thither to him and heard him read the prophet Isaiah, and said, I would never say like this. Do you understand what you're talking about? Do you understand what you're reading? And he said, How can I, except some man should guide me? And he desired Philip that he would come up and sit with him. And the place of the scripture which he read was this. He was led as a sheep to the slaughter, and like a lamb dumb before his shearer, so opened he not his mouth. Are you familiar with that scripture? Do you know where that is? Yes, of course. Isaiah 53. Same scripture you and I read was this Ethiopian eunuch reading. It's not changed. In his humiliation, his judgment was taken away. We're still in Isaiah 53. And who shall declare his generation? For his life is taken from the earth. Wow, that happened. And the eunuch answered Philip and said, I pray you, of whom speaks the prophet? Himself or some other man? Then Philip opened his mouth and began at the same scripture and preached unto him Yeshua. What was the foundation of how Philip approached this? Scripture. An inquiring mind, an inquiring heart, sincerely wanted to know what this meant, but had no one to show him. No one to show him. I think that's why what we're doing here is very important. And as they went on their way, they came unto a certain water. The eunuch said, See, here's water. What does hinder me to be baptized or immersed? Philip said, If you believe with all your heart, you may. And he answered and said, I believe that Yeshua, HaMashiach, is the Son of God. Why before was the Ethiopian not believing? He just didn't understand. Why did he believe? Someone came along and helped him understand what the prophet was saying. And out of that, he believed. And I would say this, I'll add this in there, his heart was burning enough to want to get immersed immediately. He said, I do believe with my whole heart. Is that it? Yeah, that's it. Don't think that's just Philip's job. And don't be surprised in the days to come. If somebody approaches you and say, don't you go to that Messianic Jewish congregation? You know, I don't really have an interest in going there, but I would really like to know what this means in Zechariah. Do you have any thoughts? You know? And if you don't, that's fine. Don't make something up. You don't want to make something up. Don't make anything up. But you may say, you know something, that's interesting. Could you give me a couple days? Go look at it for myself, and could we meet for coffee later in the week? Because I really am interested in myself. And see, then you'll share from a place where your heart burns for this. And when your heart burns and you're passionate about stuff, people take notice. They're like, what is different? Because our faith is in this, and we live by it, and the just shall live by their faith. Whatever disorientation I had that day, it began to dissipate because I just wasn't even focused on it. I was remembering the scriptures I've put my faith in. Father, you know what burns in my heart. You also know that sometimes the burning gets dim. You know that it's not always an on-fire thing. There's days where it's disorienting. It's because I forget or I get distracted. But Father, when I come back to it, it always does the same thing. It brings life to me. It helps me live again. Helps me want to give again and serve again and hope and endure until the end. Because I don't think there's any other way to really live but with a heart on fire. I know it's cliche, but it's what the scriptures say. Father, everybody in this room is here because they're a seeker or they're a believer. They're inquiring more of you, and they recognize they need to learn more about you. We all do. None of us have arrived. But Father, I pray that something that I've said, if I've said anything that just needs to just be forgotten, let them forget. But Father, things that I've said that represent your word, the foundation of your word, the foundation of biblical prophecy and messianic prophecy, the same scriptures that cause those disciples' hearts to burn within them after Yeshua opened those scriptures and explained it to them, I pray that that same spirit that would come and teach them and their hearts would burn as well in the midst of their problems, in the midst of the things that are going wrong in their lives, outside of them, inside of them, in their families, at their workplace, whatever's going on, that they would set those things aside, let the scripture speak, and that burning heart would supersede all of that stuff and give them the confidence and the endurance that they can make it another day because what you've written is true and it will come to pass. And one day, all sin and all pain and all sorrow and all those things will vanish away so we can hold out and be joyful, happy, and grateful in the midst of it. It's in the name of Yeshua I pray. Amen.
Amen. So Rabbi and Bob are going to come up and close the Torah. Would you please rise for the post-Torah blessing?
Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam, asher natan lanu Torah emet, v'chaye olam etah b'tocheinu. Baruch atah Adonai, noten haTorah. Amen.
Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has given us a Torah of truth, and has planted eternal life in our midst. Blessed are you, O Lord, giver of the Torah.
Etz chayim hi l'machazikim bo v'tomcheha me'ushar d'racheha d'archeha. Shalom Hashiveinu Adonai Elecha v'nashuva Hadesh Hadesh Yameinu. Yeah, man.
tree of life to those who take hold of it, and those who support it are praiseworthy. Its ways are ways of pleasantness, and all its paths are peace. Bring us back, Lord, to you, and we shall come. Renew our days of old.
Stay tuned for a short closing message from Rabbi Jim Appel.
Shalom. I'm Messianic Rabbi Jim Appel, and I hope you enjoyed our TV program. It was produced for you by Congregation Shema Yisrael, a Messianic Jewish synagogue. Shema Yisrael is a congregation of Jewish and non-Jewish people who worship the God of Israel while maintaining our Jewish identity and lifestyle, and who believe that Yeshua, whose English name is Jesus, is Israel's promised Messiah. Shema Yisrael's purposes are to proclaim Yeshua as Messiah to Jewish and non-Jewish people and help them connect personally with the God of Israel through worship. We welcome you to join our mishpacha, or family, and connect with your Jewish roots. I'd love to meet you personally at one of our weekly Shabbat services or at one of our special events where people from all backgrounds are welcome. Shalom.
We hope you enjoyed today's teaching. Call our office to request a copy on videotape. If you would like more information about Messianic Judaism or Shema Yisrael, please call us at 585-288-0670 or visit our website at www.shemayisrael.org, where you can find a listing of upcoming special events. Please join us for our weekly Shabbat service. Saturday morning, complete children's program interpretation for the deaf is available. Please notify us in advance if it is needed. Congregation Shema Yisrael also sponsors Bengals and Blessings, a Messianic music and talk radio program with Ethel Chadwick. You can also hear Bagels and Blessings by going to our website, www.shemayisrael.org, or bagelsandblessings.com. Please join us for our Messianic Judaism class, Israeli dance class, Hebrew class, or youth group. Call the office for hours and locations. Tune in next week when Reg A. Yisrael will again bring you teachings from the Scriptures.